Om Amriteshwara Namaha. Humble pranams at the lotus feet of Amma. Today I will be speaking on vasculitic disorders. Basically, my topic would be an approach to vasculitis and then looking at the constellation of symptoms. What is vasculitis? Vasculitis is inflammation in the wall of blood vessels. The symptoms and signs from vasculitis result from ischemia, infarction or hemorrhage. Now I am targeting clinical questions which may be looking at vasculitis as a differential diagnosis. When you get it in the exam, the question will be suggested. You need to pick the key features. When to suspect? Multisystem disorder with constitutional features, fever, malaise, musculoskeletal pain. These could be early hints. Raised inflammatory markers, raised ESR, raised CRP, and then look at the constellation of symptoms. You can ask that fever, weight loss, raised ESR occur in SLE and TB also. Yes, but there will definitely be more data to exclude them. You need to look at them. Remember, skin lesions are present in many cases of vasculitis, although it is not mandatory. Multiple purpuric lesions in the legs, also called palpable purpura, is characteristic of vasculitis. Remember, in thrombocytopenia, the purpura is usually non-palpable. An important MCQ for you is that scurvy is an important non-vasculitic cause of palpable purpura. So, palpable purpura can be due to causes other than vasculitis. Livedo reticularis is seen in PAN. Another differential diagnosis of livedo reticularis is the antiphospholipid syndrome. Here you can see a slide, Hinox-Schönlein with the classical palpable purpura. Another slide showing livedo reticularis, which can be seen in polyarteritis nodosa and in the antiphospholipid syndrome, also in sarcoidosis. Watch out for pulmonary TB and vaginas, both can cause cavities in lungs and create difficulty in diagnosis. Classic PAN may masquerade as infection. Antiphospholipid syndrome, infective endocarditis, cholesterol emboli, left atrial myxoma may resemble vasculitis. Always keep these mimics, vasculitis mimics in mind. Now, here is one slide showing polyarteritis nodosa. It's a vasculitis affecting the medium muscular arteries at branch points, not veins. Ischemia, which can affect nervous system, mononeuritis multiplex, renal involvement, can cause hypertension, abdominal pain, malabsorption, aneurysms, livedo reticularis, ulcers, subcutaneous nodules, gangrene, and can be systemic or cutaneous. Some secondary forms are related to hepatitis B, C, or RA, and most commonly affects men more than 50 years. So this is one of the example of vasculitis. We'll come to others subsequently. Remember, that is why, coming back to the data before the PAN slide, remember that is why one does an echo to rule out endocarditis or left atrial myxoma. Because many times you may get the features which may actually confuse you. So definitely you want to rule out endocarditis or left atrial myxoma, which can also present like vasculitis. So an echo is a diagnosis, definite investigation you will go for. You will see an appropriate situation suggestive of vasculitis that the investigations will be done, like chest X-ray, ultrasound abdomen, CT chest and abdomen, ANA, anticardiolipin antibody, IgG, IgM, lupus anticoagulant, beta-2 GP1, are usually done. Remember, in PUO setting, we want to rule out pulmonary and extrapulmonary TB, SLE, APS. We must rule out sepsis. So, unless you have ruled out all these conditions, you cannot make a diagnosis of primary vasculitis. It's very easy to, you know, once you can teach a topic very easily, but in an individual patient, when a sick patient is in front of you, then you have to use your, you know, clinical acumen, the relevant investigations, and then zero down on the most probable diagnosis. Vasculitis will emerge once all these are ruled out, and we embark on specific investigations which can include ANCA, hepatitis B, surface antigen, angiography, ENT assessment and relevant investigations, especially in vaginas, urine routine examination and microscopic examination, for obvious reasons, renal biopsy. Remember, the organs affected and ruling out other causes of systemic disease guides us in diagnosing vasculitis. Don't be surprised in a patient of vaginas with a cavitary lesion where patient has been given ATT. I recollect during my training in AIIMS, at least two cases I remember where the patient was on ATT for a long time. The patient had vaginas, but because he had cavitating lesions in the lung, he was thought to have tuberculosis, although AFB was negative. So such cases will come like that. Multiple antibiotic courses are also given to such patients. It requires a good physician, a competent physician, rheumatologist, nephrologist, pulmonologist with good radiological support and lab support to reach diagnosis of vasculitis fairly rapidly. Keep that in mind. Here I will now briefly discuss some of the constellations which are there in a particular vasculitis syndrome and predominant size of vessels involved. The first is palpable purpura on legs and buttocks, arthralgia, arthritis, abdominal pain, microscopic or gross hematuria. And more so if it is below 15 years, obviously Hinox-Schönlein would be the first diagnosis, HSP. Small vessel vasculitis, it is a small vessel vasculitis. Now look at the second scenario, bloody nasal discharge, scleritis in a patient with respiratory complaints, plus urinary sediment, abnormality oblique elevated creatinine, and respiratory complaints, there is cough, hemoptysis and chest pain. So obviously GPA, vaginers is very much in your mind. You can have the ear, nose, throat, lung and kidney, three organs can be involved. Remember, it's not always that all three will be involved. Sometimes you may have only ENT and lung. Sometimes you may have only lung and kidney. So it is very important to understand the whole disease process, then you will be able to diagnose. And here small vessels and medium sized arteries are involved. Next, coming to palpable purpura, rapidly progressive renal failure, constitutional features and asymmetric neuropathy, MPA, microscopic polyangiitis, small vessels and medium sized arteries. Here you see rapidly progressive renal failure, that is very characteristic. And they can also have involvement of the lung. They can have pulmonary diffuse alveolar hemorrhage also. Vaginas is infamous for its subtle presentation and its lethality if it is not correctly diagnosed and treated. It's caused by autoantibodies against proteinase 3 and positive C ANCA. So when you do immunofluorescence, you will see a cytoplasmic pattern. But the antibody which is seen is against proteinase 3. And you can have, as you can be seen, as I mentioned, ENT involvement, the lung involvement, the renal involvement. So keep all these things in mind. It's always good to have these diagnoses in your mind. Now the fourth constellation, long-standing asthma, allergic rhinitis, nasal polyps, eosinophilia with recent development of classic pan-like features plus fetid pulmonary infiltrates. So remember, what is giving away is eosinophilia and long-standing asthma. This is EGPA, Churg-Strauss syndrome. Small vessel and medium-sized arteries are involved in this. Now look at this, the fifth scenario. Abdominal pain, massive GI bleed, asymmetric sensory and motor peripheral neuropathy, hypertension, digital gangrene, weight loss and muscle pain. This is basically classic polyarteritis nodosa because of medium-sized arterial involvement. Now, the scenario of a child, usually infant, with fever and sick look, irritable, strawberry tongue, lymphadenopathy, palmar and plantar erythema, induration of dorsum of hands, desquamation of skin and perianal region. Basically, Kawasaki's disease, of basically medium-sized involvement. Very classic. It's found in India, so don't think it is not found in India. It's in fact very large number of patients reported from PGI. Most of these patients are not diagnosed correctly. This is another representation of Kawasaki's disease. Then chronic non-healing punched out ulcers over extremities. Basically cutaneous pan. It's not systemic pan, cutaneous pan. Polyarteritis nodosa, where there will be a deep dermal vasculitis. Medium-sized arteries in deep dermis and subcutis are involved. Then we have bruise or absent pulses in young females with systemic hypertension with or without constitutional features, raised inflammatory markers. Classic Takayasu's, large vessel vasculitis as you have been taught. These are the pneumano classification of Takayasu's arteritis, type 1 to type 5. Various patterns you can see for yourself. Here you can see basically the Takayasu's where, you know, in angiography, you can see where the thinning of the vessel is there. There is a cutoff or there is a decreased flow along the vessels. So you have seen an example of the normal and you can see the abnormal. Now in headache in elderly with tenderness over temples, sometimes with sudden visual loss, jaw claudication with or without a background of polymyalgia rheumatica. Vasculitis syndrome, giant cell arteritis, predominant cell of size of vessel is large arteries. Then another constellation, recurrent oral ulcers with or without genital ulcers, particularly accompanying ocular complaints or superficial thrombophlebitis or DVT. Basically, Behçet syndrome, small, medium or large vessels can be involved. Any one, two or all. Variable, this is an example of a variable vessel vasculitis. Now, Behçet's also, you can have ocular involvement, neuro Behçet's, aphthous ulcers, angio Behçet's, skin lesions, genitourinary lesions, deep venous occlusions and arthritis, usually affecting large joints. Now, I'll start with the clinical scenario. A 4-year-old girl is brought to the hospital with fever high grade of 3 days and is irritable. Clinical examination reveals conjunctival edema, erythematous maculopapular rash, strawberry tongue, bilateral cervical lymphadenopathy. You can look at the slide of, you know, in, which has been shown in the past also. Now the investigations reveals HB 8.9 gram percent, TLC 18,200, ESR 86 and CRP 120. What is the likely diagnosis? She was started on an IV drug as a single infusion. Name and dose of the drug. If it is not treated promptly, what are the complications? Answers. It is Kawasaki disease, a medium vessel vasculitis, IVIG 2 grams per kg given to the patient, and coronary artery abnormalities and acquired cardiac disease can occur if the patient is not treated appropriately. Some facts which will help in MCQs. Kawasaki is a Japanese pediatrician. It is a commonest childhood vasculitis, most common cause of acquired heart disease in children. Maximum Kawasaki is seen in Japan, Korea and Taiwan, seen in India also. PGI has shown more 4.54 per lakh children under 15 years. So they do have seen, and so it is seen all over the country and managed appropriately. PGI has got one of the largest experience. Maximum in less than 5 years age, and boys are usually affected more than girls. Now clinical features, classically recurrent fever, strawberry tongue, sick irritable child, perianal and periungual desquamation, less than 5 years maximum, can occur less than 15 years, and as you know it is a medium vessel vasculitis, other example of this being polyarteritis nodosa. Differentials can be viral fever, Stevens-Johnson syndrome, acute streptococcal pharyngitis, dengue fever where platelet is usually low. Now keep one thing in mind, when the sick child is there, you know, you have to see him clinically, him or her clinically, and then come to a very rapid diagnosis. You can't waste time, because if it is, and you don't give IVIG to a patient of Kawasaki's, then definitely that delay can be very, very dangerous for the patient. Treatment, IVIG 2 gram per kg IV infusion over 10 hours, 10 to 15% present with failure following this. In failure, we can repeat IVIG or give IV methylprednisolone or injection infliximab, which is an anti-TNF agent used in rheumatoid also. Coronary artery abnormalities decrease from 25% to 2% with IVIG. So you can well imagine how important it is to diagnose this disease and treat correctly. Mucocutaneous lymph node disease is another name for Kawasaki disease. A very important that if you remember this, remember mucocutaneous lymph node disease. Three parts, three important components are there in this. So you should know this. Coronary artery complications are dreadful. So when in doubt, give IVIG if clinical suspicion is high. Now I deal with another clinical scenario. A 40-year-old lady complained of pain in right shin after a long walk. Pain was persistent. 2 months later, she developed ankle edema and skin nodules mimicking erythema nodosum. USG was within normal limits, no symptoms of peripheral nerve involvement, hemogram was normal, CRP was 25 mg per liter, no autoantibodies, ANCA ANA negative, X-ray of right leg showed periosteal thickening of right fibula. It's thickening of right fibula. MRI of both lower limbs showed contrast enhancement of leg muscles. Skin biopsy showed necrotizing vasculitis of a medium-sized artery. What is the diagnosis? GPA, PAN, EGPA or sarcoidosis? Salient features of PAN. Here this is a patient of PAN. Necrotizing angiitis that affects medium-sized arteries and can involve major organs. Can be primary or secondary. Example, secondary to hepatitis B. Infection, hepatitis B, usually associated in 20% cases of PAN. Earlier, microscopic polyangiitis was clubbed with PAN. Later, we learned link with ANCA in MPA and diffuse alveolar hemorrhage and glomerulonephritis in MPA, unlike PAN. And MPA is separated out of this entity. The 1990 ACR criteria for PAN, weight loss more than 4 kgs, livido reticularis, we have shown you an image, testicular pain, see more images, testicular pain or tenderness, myalgia, weakness in leg muscles, see your case vignette, has been discussed, mononeuropathy or polyneuropathy, mononeuritis multiplex, diastolic BP more than 90 mmHg, elevated BUN or creatinine, hepatitis B virus, arteriographic abnormalities and biopsy of small or medium sized artery. This is a slide showing livido reticularis, which can be seen in PAN. Chapel Hill consensus. The necrotizing PAN is a necrotizing arthritis of medium or small arteries without glomerulonephritis or vasculitis in arterioles, capillaries or venules and is not associated with ANCA. So these are very crucial. ANCA will be negative. Then no glomerulonephritis or vasculitis in arterioles, capillaries or venules. Very important is medium or small arteries, aneurysm may be seen in angiography. Aneurysm in artery is suggestive of PAN. No glomerulonephritis, which is different from MPA, which has glomerulonephritis. ANCA negative, which is different from Wegener's MPA, Churg-Strauss, which are ANCA positive, can be ANCA positive. Biopsy is usually a deep skin biopsy, muscle biopsy, distal is better than proximal, nerve biopsy in mononeuritis multiplex, example sural nerve biopsy, small intestinal biopsy in intestinal gangrene. So it depends on, see, like you can either do a diagnostic or sometimes after post-op also, a patient develops intestinal gangrene and in resection and anastomosis, when you study the pathology, you find that the features of medium vessel vasculitis are there, clinches the diagnosis. Maximum these patients are 40 to 60 years and male are more affected than female and joint pains can occur. Amyotrophy of muscles and pain can occur, neuropathy, skin involvement, cardiac, MI can occur, renal because of aneurysms in artery, however no glomerulonephritis. GIT is most severe, it can occur in 1/3 patients, especially hepatitis B positive ones have GIT involvement. Orchitis can occur due to testicular involvement. Lung is usually spared unlike MPA and Wegener's. Investigations, increased ESR, HbSAg as discussed, biopsy and angiography to look for aneurysms. treatment, when combined steroids and cyclophosphamide, the survival is 82%. Now, basically, one can give IV methylpred 3 pulses, 1000 milligram IV infusion. Oral steroids 1 milligram per kg per day are normally given after the infusions and then taper. Cyclophosphamide about 15 milligram per kg, say in a 50 kg patient you would give 750. You give 3 infusions, 3 pulses, 0, 14 and 28 days, and then every 3 weeks 3 additional pulses, later every 3 months, and after 6 months of treatment with cyclophosphamide we can switch over to azathioprine. This has very good results. But in addition, we can also use drugs like rituximab. We can use other drugs also, not necessarily cyclophosphamide. Remember PAN, Wegener's, Churg-Strauss, MPA, Enoxaparin, Kawasaki's, Takayasu, giant cell arteritis, polymyalgia rheumatica and relapsing polychondritis. All sound difficult but are not that difficult. Questions on these topics were generally going to be rather easy once you grasp it, and you'll be able to succeed in this. Thank you very much.